So, good evening, everybody. And I think we are close to C and T. So, after good afternoon, I think I'm the first speaker to start with the good evening. And we'll keep it light after all that statistical analysis and all, because I don't happen to be an expert on that. And I think just quickly running through these, I will discuss more on the context of the indicators or the performance management rather than the exact indicators. I think they've been repeated time and again since morning, and they will be continued tomorrow as well. About a brief introduction, I think about ASSE, what I'm representing, American Society of Safety Engineers. I'll skip this in the wake of time. We have a booth outside. We can meet there and discuss and have a cup of tea or coffee and then continue. So I think we'll try to push you into tea or coffee, and you can be in that mode even during the presentation. It's not a very tech heavy presentation. This is the overall global presence. I'll skip it again. I think first thing what I was evaluating when the topic was there with the performance management was whether it is an HSE topic or a HR topic. I think a lot of us, including the part on the BBS and the performance management, we can't stand alone when we are talking about an HSE performance. I mean, we can't have a set of indicators, leading, lagging, whatever tools we decide, in isolation of the performance management systems which are designed or established by the organizations. And what I mean by that in terms of the context of how it would differ with is that we can learn a lot of indicators. I think Phil ran through a whole list of them during his moderation initial thing, and I don't think I have anything else to add on to that. But point is how to select. I think a few of the speakers already spoke on to that, but how to also select in the correct context of the organizations. I think one is we presumed in a number of presentations that we know the bow tie diagram and all. I think I learned it about a few weeks back from one of the speakers present here itself. But when you go around, I think starting first before even the bow tie diagram on the overall performance management, I think still a large chunk of the organizations would not have a formal or an automated or a structured PMS. When we are talking about applying it, we are talking about application to certain industries, like Sama talked about the automated systems and other things. But if you see it in the entire of the complete horizon of the industry and take it out of the oil and gas context or take it to the L2 levels and others, I think still a large number of organizations may not have a formal performance management systems. And to talk about HSE performance management system may be slightly far-fetched in that case. Coming to the organizations which have a formal management system, I think that is one of the prerequisites, because we can't put the things in isolation. Like, we have a HSE performance management system, so it has to be put up. You need to it for the GRI reporting or the corporate reporting, so have some lagging, leading indicators and all that and put it up. I think one of the initial needs is to align it to the organizational maturity. You would still have, we talked about the organizations where the people may be knowing about the leading or lagging indicators, where we are talking about the performance measurement methods, the tools and all. But still you would have a large number of organizations, and how to select can be different is, we still see a large, some of the organizations, I won't say very large numbers, where our previous speaker mentioned that hiding is not possible. I think we've come across cases whereby 4 to 5 fatalities per facility can be hidden in a day. So if we are talking about selecting an indicators for those organizations, and we are talking about a ratio of a near miss to a major accident, it would not be relevant to those organizations, because still they have not even reached the definition of near miss and the intricacy of how to measure a near miss or which would have a higher potential or not. And then you have organizations who would be proactive, then dependent, interdependent. Some of the indicators which are there on the slides which have been put up is, first thing is the data integrity, as I mentioned itself. Then focus on early warning systems. That's where we were talking about near miss to accident ratio. Those are the kind of organizations you're talking about. The definitions of near miss, the clarity in the definitions across the whole spectrum. And then the next level of organization which are talking about or aligning the performance indicators to the organizational goals. And I think operational risk mitigation may not be the only goal. There can be various other goals, and the performance indicators for the same organization for the would vary from the division to division and also from time to time. For example, a company may be having an goal of shifting from an entrepreneurship based controlled model to a professional based model and going in for a listing. Another company may be having an already matured system running for 10 years and then they are looking for what kind of tools can be used for the performance measurement or how to use the performance measurement tools. So the set of indicators and not the indicators will be only one part of it. Coming back to the concept of performance management, as I said, like measuring or identifying what we discussed is only one element if you see on the right side of the slide where performance management has been defined. Also aligning to the performance with the strategic goals of the organization, we discussed about that. So I'll not repeat onto that. What are the essential inputs that would go in? One is the strategic goals that we discussed, and as I said, it cannot be a single goal. It would have to be multiple goals, and those multiple goals would also keep changing with time. One of the other challenges, some of the challenges were already mentioned by the previous speakers, we see is that the pace of changes in the strategic goals or strategic direction is not matched by the pace of changes in the performance indicators. So the set of indicators that we've been discussing as a leading or lagging indicators are something that might have been discussed for last 3 years, 5 years or something, but the pace at which the organizational or strategic goals are changing is much faster than that, and it keeps changing faster and faster. So I gave you the example of the strategic goals. Coming to the organizational structure, I think the other challenges in terms of the organizational structure, we talked about the measurement and how to take the measurements. One is the tools, second is the people. In terms of the people, do we have the adequate resources? We had this is a debate that will be ongoing, like what we mentioned, what cannot be measured, cannot be managed, and also is it too much to manage or is it too much to measure or everything gets importance, as Phil mentioned. I think that is an ongoing discussion, but coming to the organization structure, we need to also evaluate in terms of what normally a business entrepreneur would look at is the cost to benefit ratio. So it may be good to measure a performance indicator and so that we are able to manage it, but is the likely benefit likely to exceed the cost of measurement or the efforts put into the measure them? The third part is the roles, responsibilities, and competence. Would back to differ on some of the points that yes, if you go out, I think with the people we've been interacting, more than 50% of the safety professionals, I don't think would have a mathematics background to understand the analysis or the statistics of that. And a lot of organizations would have a safety committee, and I'm not restricting to only oil and gas. More than 90% of the safety committee professionals would not be able to calculate the lost time indicators. So you're talking about a spectrum of industries where we need to move out of just the industries which are into, say, oil and gas and all and take it. So we need to select those performance indicators which are simplified, and there has to be a balance of simplification, but at the same time, giving it a comprehensive approach. What are the essential outputs? I think rewards, recognitions, system improvements, we all talked about it. Challenges, some people already mentioned about missing input. Input elements, as I said, would include your tools and the measurement techniques. We talked about the competence, people, and other things which are part of the challenges. Balancing comprehensiveness to the manageability. I think we were already discussing about it, so I'll skip that. Then on the continuous professional upgradation, I think this again brings in, for example, some of the challenges with changes in the organizational context. We've been talking about the risks, and there are new risks emerging if you see across, for example, the security versus safety risk. One of the speakers in the morning mentioned about the BSE versus HSE, right? I happened to be at the BSE about a couple of weeks back, and for the security reasons, If you see, the front part has been done in a thatched manner, and it creates a big fire hazard. No clear-cut designations of where are the staircases. There's only one set of staircase. So point is, we are trying to cover up one risk which is related to security by having another risk which is of safety. So how to balance the two? I'm not saying that is lesser important, but how much risk are we covering and how much additional risk we are generating? These are not captured in the conventional performance measurement tools. So that is where it has to be set in terms of the context of the organization, the capability of the people to measure it. And that is where a continuous professional upgradation of both the HSE staff, the HR staff, in terms of training them on the performance indicators of the KPIs or the HSE performance indicators, and also the line managers is an important one. So I think that's one area for continuous professional development, not only for HSE, but also for others, as I mentioned, both for the line managers and the professional, and the, say for example, HR professionals, to have their skills upgraded and also at a pace which is in line with the changing context of the organization. And these are some of the opportunities for the continuous professional development for both human resources as well as the HSE staff. And I think we'll stop here, and if Phil would feel that he has time, he can take a couple of questions. Otherwise, I think we can have the questions over the tea break. Thank you, Phil.